Heavenly Father, thank you for today, and thank you for the blessings that you pour into our lives. Thank you for the ways in which you speak to us through your word and by your Son, Jesus Christ. As we study your word together this morning, we pray that you would open the eyes of our hearts to receive and believe what you say. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, this morning, both in worship and in ABC, we are wrapping up this little series called Little Letter I. And this series is really all about our identity. It's about how we define ourselves, the identities that we claim for ourselves. Because in our culture and in our society, we define ourselves, we claim our identities in a bunch of different ways. Some people define themselves by the money that they make or the job that they have, the philanthropy that they engage in, the grades that we get, the team that we love. But the Bible says there's actually a much different and a much better way to define ourselves, and that is the way of Jesus Christ. The Apostle Paul puts it like this, Philippians 3, verses 7 and 8. He says, "But whatever were gains to me, I now consider a loss for the sake of Jesus Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I've lost all things. I consider all that other stuff garbage that I may gain Jesus Christ." Here's what Paul is saying. He's saying there were a lot of different gains that I used to use to define myself. The gain of my piety, the gain of my holiness, the gain of my knowledge, the gain of my strength, the gain of my position in society. I had lots of gains, but when I met Christ, my gains turned to garbage. Because all that really matters for me now, who I want to be known as now, is a follower of Jesus Christ. He is how I define myself, Paul says. And so the question that we're asking in this series is, if that's how Paul defines himself, how do we define ourselves? Now, today, as we wrap up our series, we're going to be talking about the practice of sharing. Because this is one of the things to which we are called as people who define ourselves by Jesus Christ. We are called to be generous with the blessings that he has given us. We are called to be sharers. In fact, a sharer is the very nature of who our God is. Titus chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. God saved us, not because of righteous things that we had done, but because of his mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ our Savior. And the word that I want you to pick up on is this adverb generously, because that is a word that describes the action of our God. Our God is generous with us. He shares with us. He shares with us his grace. He shares with us his mercy. He shares with us his one and only Son, Jesus Christ. And because God has been generous with us, because he shared with us, we ought to be generous with others. We ought to share with others. You know, my daughter, Hope, she's 3 years old, and she has a lot of toys. One of the nice things about working at a church like Concordia is that a lot of people just like God are very generous, and they're very generous to us and to our family, and all of your generosity has mean that Hope gets a lot of toys. She's received all sorts of toys from all sorts of people. In fact, in our house, we have this loft upstairs, and it is filled with toys, and she loves them all. That is, she loved them all until about a few months ago when her little brother Hayden, who is now 7 months old, began to get interested in playing with toys. Because now the toys that Hope is most interested in are not the toys that she has up in her loft. They are whatever toy Hayden happens to be playing with at the moment. And heaven forbid, if she is playing with a toy and Hayden comes crawling along and he begins to look interested in it, all of a sudden she becomes very protective of her toy and she holds it really close. And she says to Hayden over and over again, "No, Hayden, it's my toy. It's my toy. It's my toy." You know, I was thinking about this. It's a funny thing. Even from the youngest of our years, sharing, being generous, is not something that really comes naturally to us. It is a learned behavior. It's something we got to practice. We are naturally inclined to be protective of our stuff rather than generous with our stuff. In fact, if we're honest with ourselves, we live in a culture, just broadly, that can be very skeptical of sharing. I mean, be honest. Have you ever been driving down the road, you see a panhandler on the side of the road, and he has a sign, and he says he needs help because he's homeless, he's down on his luck, and you think to yourself, I wonder how much money that guy makes every day panhandling. You ever wonder if they're taking you for a ride? Be skeptical of sharing. Have you ever had somebody in your life who was needy? And you want to help them. You want to share with them, but it seems like the more you share, the more they take. And eventually, you just kind of get burned out when it comes to sharing with them. You become kind of skeptical of sharing. Have you ever found yourself in a position where you just don't feel like and think that you have enough to share? Maybe you yourself have hit some tough financial times, and people are still asking for your money or for your time, for your assistance, for your whatever, and you're thinking to yourself, I just don't have it. And you become very skeptical of sharing. In our culture, we don't share a lot. Even things that we call sharing aren't really sharing. For example, anybody ever heard of ride sharing? This is what has made Uber so incredibly popular. You can get a ride from point A to point B a lot cheaper using an Uber than you'd be able to get a ride from point A to point B using a taxi, and also it's a lot faster than you'd be able to do it getting a bus. But here's the deal. Even though we call this ride sharing, it's really more ride buying and ride selling, right? It's not so much about sharing a ride. It's about paying for a ride or making money off of giving somebody else a ride. It's not exactly sharing. It's more commerce. In our culture, we don't do a very good job at sharing. We're kind of skeptical of it. And yet, in the Bible, sharing is a really big deal. Two examples of this. Hebrews 13, verse 16. Preacher Hebrews says, "Do not forget to do good and to share with others. For with such sacrifices, God is pleased." And here's what I want you to notice. The preacher of Hebrews equates sharing with sacrifice. He says, "I want you not to forget to share with others, for with such sacrifices, God is pleased." The preacher of Hebrews knows something about sharing. He knows that sharing can be hard for us. Because sharing can require a sacrifice of us. It can take us out of our comfort zone a little bit. That is why the preacher of Hebrews encourages us and exhorts us to share. Because he knows that sharing doesn't come naturally to us. Second example, in the book of Isaiah, the prophet is criticizing the nation of Israel for their fallow fasts. The people of Israel, they're very spiritual. They do all sorts of spiritual things like fasting. They engage in all sorts of religious sounding activities. But they refuse to do what matters most in God's eyes. They fast a lot, but they don't share a lot. And Isaiah calls them on the carpet for this. Isaiah 58, verse 4, the prophet says, "You cannot fast as you do today and expect your voice to be heard on high." And then God says, "Is this not the kind of fasting that I have chosen? To loose the chains of injustice, to untie the cords of the yoke, to set the oppressed free, and to break every yoke? Is it not to share your food with the hungry, to provide the poor wanderer with shelter, when you see the naked to clothe them, and not to turn away from your own flesh and blood?" God says to the people through the prophet Isaiah, you fast from food, but you're not doing the stuff that matters the most. You're not sharing. You're not sharing your prestige by loosening the chains of injustice or helping the oppressed. You're not housing your wanderer or giving your resources to the poor. You see, when you just fast, here's what you do. You give up. You give up something. In this case, you give up food. When you share, you take it one step farther and you give of. You give of yourself to somebody else, and that's Isaiah 58 says, is what we are truly called to. We're called to be sharers. Now, it's all of this that takes us to our text for today, because in Luke chapter 19, we're going to see a man who, just like a lot of us, has a bit of a problem with sharing. And so if you got a Bible, open there now. Luke 19 beginning at verse 1. Luke 19 beginning at verse 1. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector, and he was very wealthy. Let's pause right there. As our story for today opens, we're introduced to a tax collector. His name is Zacchaeus. Now, just so you know, the name Zacchaeus in Hebrew actually means pure and righteous. But here's the other thing you need to know. In the first century, people looked at tax collectors as anything but pure and righteous. You see, in the first century, people looked at tax collectors a lot differently than we look at tax collectors in our day. When we see a guy with an IRS emblazoned on his uniform, we get excited, right? We like tax collectors. We cannot wait to give our money to the government. You know, April 15th is our favorite day of the year. But back then, believe it or not, people were a little more skeptical of tax collectors. Rather than being universally accepted and celebrated and adored, tax collectors in that day were despised and hated. They were looked upon with suspicion. In fact, it's interesting. If you go back and look at some of the ancient literature, tax collectors are mentioned all over all sorts of ancient literature pieces. In Athenian literature, tax collectors are mentioned. In Egyptian literature, tax collectors are mentioned. In Roman literature, tax collectors are mentioned. In Palestinian literature, tax collectors are mentioned. You want to know how many of these references in all of these different ancient sources actually paint tax collectors in a positive light? Not a one of them. Because in the ancient world, tax collectors were looked upon with universal disdain. Now, part of the reason the ancient Jews hated tax collectors so much was because tax collectors worked for the government of Rome, and the Jews didn't really like the Romans. And when you were a tax collector for the government of Rome, here's the way this worked. You had a certain quota that you needed to meet. In other words, Rome wouldn't collect a certain percentage of everybody's income. They would just give their tax collectors a set amount, say like 10,000 denarii. And the tax collectors would have to go out and get 10,000 denarii and bring that back to the Roman government, which means the tax collectors didn't really care who it came from because it didn't really matter. They just had to get 10,000 denarii no matter what. And so you could be rich or you could be poor. You could be well off or you could be barely scraping by. You could have lots of means or you could have no means at all. The tax collectors were going to do whatever they could to meet their quota because they knew they had to turn in 10,000 denarii to the Roman government. So if it meant they had to rough you up or threaten you or cajole you or scare you, they were going to do it because they had a quota to get to. But it actually went beyond that, because obviously, if the Roman government says, bring us 10,000 denarii, and you as a tax collector go out, work for the Roman government, and collect 10,000 denarii, how many denarii does that leave you to live on? None. And so you have to collect above and beyond what your quota is. And how much above and beyond what your quota is you collect, that's up to you. And so you have a choice. You could either barely collect over your quota and just kind of scrape by in life, or you could collect a lot over your quota and live quite comfortably. Now, given those two options, which option do you think most tax collectors went with? Barely collecting over your quota and barely scraping by, or collecting a lot over your quota and living comfortably? Option A or option B, most tax collectors went with option B. After all, you can make a good living taking money from other people. Now, of course, this didn't really sit well with most people. After all, there was a whole profession in the ancient world that rather than making a living in the private sector and producing goods, they simply took wealth from others and gave it to themselves. And so there were these debates in the first century about tax policy, how much tax was to tax, and if it was fair that a whole public sector of people lived off the money that was made in the private sector. Does any of this sound familiar to you? Nothing seems to change. And so tax collectors were hated, and here's Zacchaeus in Luke 19, and he's a tax collector. But he's more than just a tax collector. He is the chief tax collector. Here's what that means. He's a bigwig. He's high up the IRS totem pole. In fact, notice that Luke makes a special point in verse 2 to say that this tax collector named Zacchaeus was wealthy, which means that he wasn't just taking a little bit more from people than he needed to barely scrape by in his life. He was taking a lot more from people than he needed so that he could live in the lap of luxury. Here's Zacchaeus, and here's what Zacchaeus is not good at. He's not good at sharing. He's good at taking, but he's not very good at giving. But as much luxury as Zacchaeus lived in, Zacchaeus, we see, was kind of an empty man. He had a spot in his soul that needed some filling. Luke 19, verse 3, Zacchaeus wanted to see who Jesus was. But because he was short and he could not see over the crowd, he ran ahead and he climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. Zacchaeus is in the town of Jericho, and Zacchaeus catches wind that Jesus is coming to the town of Jericho, and Zacchaeus has heard of Jesus. And so Zacchaeus, the tax collector, wants to see Jesus, but Zacchaeus has a problem, and the problem is his height. Zacchaeus, Luke 19 says, is short. In fact, just kind of a side note here, in that day, people were not as tall as they are in our day. Nobody ever hit 6 feet tall in that day. And so to be short and not to be able to see over everybody else probably meant that Zacchaeus was less than 5 feet tall. He was somewhere in the 4 foot some odd inches range. And so he was a really short guy. And Zacchaeus wants to be able to see over the crowd, so what does Zacchaeus do? He climbs a tree. Now, in our day and age, there are three things that climb trees, right? Number one, kids climb trees. If you've got kids or grandkids, you know they love to climb trees. Number two, cats climb trees, right? They like to get up the tree, get away from the dog, get away from the whatever. And that leads me to number three, firemen climb trees. Why? Because they got to get the cat down that just climbed the tree. Okay? Those are the three entities that climb trees. When was the last time you spent a lot of time climbing a tree just for fun? Probably been a while, right? No, it's been a while for me. Because even in our day, we consider tree climbing, it may be fun for kids, but it's for kids. It's kind of silly, kind of goofy, kind of childish. Now, what is true in our day was also true back in Zacchaeus' day. If you were a grown man, you would never climb a tree. People would wonder what in the world was going on with you. You didn't have a tree house as an adult. And so here's what Zacchaeus does. He climbs a tree, and all he really does in front of the crowd is he makes himself look a little bit silly and stupid. He makes himself look a little bit childish, but he does so that he can see Jesus. Now again, in our day and age, we don't want to look childish. And yet one of the hallmarks of following Jesus is that we have a childlike faith. Jesus himself says, Mark 10, verse 15, truly I tell you, anybody who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it. Real famous story, one of the most famous theologians of the previous century was a guy named Karl Barth. He was a Swiss Reformed theologian. He wrote a 13-volume work. It was called Church Dogmatics, thousands and thousands of pages. He was also part of a church that was opposed to Hitler in a day when many in the church were trying to work with Hitler. There was a time after the war in 1962 when Karl Barth was getting near the end of his life. He's paying a visit to the States and somebody says to him, Dr. Barth, if you were to summarize your theological stance, if you were to summarize the essence of the millions of words that you have published, the thousands of pages that you have written, if you were going to try to boil down the essence of Christianity to one thing, what would it be? And here's what Dr. Barth said. He said, after all my study, this is what I've learned. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Now, Karl Barth was a guy who still, to this day, is considered by many to be the greatest theologian of the 20th century. He was a great mind, a profound lecturer, a voluminous writer. And yet, even with all his academic credentials, you know what he still had? A childlike faith. There's a part of us that needs this. No matter how educated or how refined or how intelligent or how enlightened we may become, there's a part of us that needs a childlike faith. And here's why. A childlike faith leads us to humility. Because the childlike faith reminds us that we can't sort everything out. We can't figure everything out. We can't know everything there is to know. There is still mystery to faith. There's still mystery to the universe and to creation and even to God. Great quote from the church father Augustine. Augustine says this. He says, the crowd will laugh at the lowly. People who are walking in the way of humility. Say what you like, but for our part, let us climb the sycamore tree and see Jesus. The reason you can't see Jesus is that you're too ashamed. You're too adult. You're too proud to climb the sycamore tree. That's what Zacchaeus was not ashamed to do. And because he wasn't ashamed to do it, what happens next is amazing. Luke 19, verse 5, when Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and he said to Zacchaeus, "Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today." Zacchaeus' willingness to climb a tree like a little kid, to let go of a little bit of his dignity and his pride, to humble himself just so he can see Jesus, gets this response from Jesus. Verse 5, he says, "Zacchaeus, come on down. I want to stay at your house today." Now, it's important to understand here that what Jesus says here in one way is kind of strange, right? Because generally, you don't invite yourself over to somebody's house, right? If you want to go over to somebody's house, you don't say, "I must come to your house today." You say, "May I stay at your house next week or next month?" That way you have time to clean up and get things ready, right? You don't tell, you ask. What does Jesus do with Zacchaeus? He doesn't ask, he tells. And he doesn't give Zacchaeus any sort of notice. He says, "I'm going to stay at your house today. Ready or not," Jesus says, "here I come." Now, that could be construed as being a little bit rude, right? Somebody does that to you and you get a little bit uncomfortable. But there's actually something very deep and very profound in the way that Jesus addresses Zacchaeus, the way that Jesus says to Zacchaeus, "I'm coming over to your house right now." Because at the same time that it is generally considered rude to invite yourself over to somebody's house right then and there, we do have a few people, very few people, in our lives who have permission to do just that, right? Family members, real close friends. We don't really care if they call and say, "Hey, I'm coming over in 5 minutes. See you in a bit." I remember years ago, I had a close friend who was really struggling with a big decision that he had to make about where he was going to go and do some graduate work. And he had reached kind of an existential crisis. He had reached a breaking point because there was a school here in San Antonio that he could have gone to. There was another school out of state that he was kind of drawn to, but he was scared of leaving Texas because he's a true Texas boy. And so he calls me one night, and he's crying. And he says, "I need to come over." And honestly, I didn't bat an eye. It didn't bug me a bit. We sat out on the back porch, talked things through. Decided to go to that out-of-state school, and now he's back in Texas after graduating from that out-of-state school. He's doing fine, doing great. He's back where he loves and belongs. But most of us have people like that, right? People, you don't really mind if they say, "Hey, I'm coming over in a little bit." Now, here's the key. Jesus is treating Zacchaeus like he's one of those people to him. He's treating Zacchaeus like he can just barge in and crash at his house and it's no big deal. "Hey, I'm coming over." Jesus is treating Zacchaeus like a dear, personal friend. Now, this right here would have been shocking to anybody and everybody who's watching this whole scene unfold with this guy up in a tree and Jesus saying, "Hey, I'm coming over to your house right now." Because as a tax collector, the general assumption was, how many close personal friends do you have? Who's egg? None. Everybody hated Zacchaeus. They treated him like he was a traitor. They treated him like he was an evil rich guy. They treated him like he was evil incarnate. But then here's Jesus, and what does Jesus treat him like? Jesus doesn't treat him like a traitor. Jesus treats him like a friend. "Hey, I'm coming over to your house. Ready or not, here I come." There is a reason that people grumbled about Jesus and said things like Luke 7, verse 34, "Here is a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners." Jesus went out of his way to befriend people that nobody else would befriend. Now, this teaches us a very profound truth about the way that Jesus works. Here's what Jesus does. Jesus has a funny way of befriending the people that we like the least. The people that we think are scoundrels, the people that we think are rotten and worthless and frustrating, Jesus always befriends those people. In this day, people hated tax collectors because they were traitors to the Roman government. They were rich at the expense of people who owned private businesses and made the economy go. And you know what Jesus says? "I want to be the friend of tax collectors. The evil rich guys, I'm their friend." At the same time, there were other people in this day who looked past the poor, who figured, hey, they weren't a big deal. They didn't have a lot of power. They didn't have a lot of prestige. They didn't have a lot of clout in that day and in that age, kind of like in our day and in our age. Does Jesus look past the poor? No, he befriends them and celebrates them. A widow comes to the temple in Jerusalem one day to bring her offering. And all these guys are putting in these huge sums of money into the temple treasury. She comes along, she puts in only a few pennies. What offering does Jesus notice and celebrate? The widow's offering of only a few pennies. Mark 12, verse 43, Jesus calls his disciples to him and he says, "Truly I tell you, this poor widow has put more into the treasury than all the others. They all gave out of their wealth. But she, out of her poverty, put in everything, all that she had to look on." Here's what Jesus does. He always befriends people that other people overlook. He always befriends people that we like the least. If you're here and you're rich, you need to know this. Jesus befriends poor people. If you're here and you're poor and you're kind of frustrated with the rich fat class, you need to know that Jesus befriends rich people. If you're a citizen of this country, Jesus befriends people of other countries. If you're from somewhere else and you're kind of frustrated because you think Americans can be kind of arrogant sometimes, you need to remember that Jesus loves the people of this country. If you're educated, remember Jesus makes friends with the uneducated. If you're a little bit more down home, remember Jesus loves those elitist snobs you like to rail against. If you're a Republican, yes, Jesus is friends with Democrats too. If you're a liberal, remember Jesus likes conservatives as well. This is Jesus. Crosses every cultural boundary, loves everybody. Here's why. There is nobody that Jesus doesn't want to be a part of his kingdom. He wants everybody to be a part of his kingdom, so he will make friends with everybody to call them to himself. Now, here's the tough question for us, right? If that's who Jesus befriended, if he always befriended the people that everybody else liked the least, who should we be befriending? That's the question. Now, Zacchaeus, when he has a friend in Jesus, he's ecstatic. He is thrilled to be considered a close personal friend of Jesus, so much so that Jesus would invite himself over to his house unannounced. And so here is how Zacchaeus responds. Luke 19, verse 6. Zacchaeus came down at once and welcomed Jesus gladly. Now, a quick bit of Greek here for you. The Greek word for welcomed is the word hypodekomai, made up of two different parts. Hypo, this is a preposition from which we kind of get an English word hyper. This is an intensifier preposition. And dekomai is a word that means to receive. And so here's the idea. When Jesus comes over to Zacchaeus' house, he doesn't just welcome him, he hyper welcomes him. He doesn't just greet him at the door with a, "Hey, how you doing? Come on in." He welcomes him with a hearty handshake. He has hors d'oeuvres waiting for him. He rolls out the red carpet for Jesus. He's so excited. He has somebody who likes him. Somebody who has befriended him. Now, unsurprisingly, when this happens, tongues begin to wag. Because Jesus has just befriended somebody in the ancient world that everybody else would have hated. And so, Luke 19, verse 7, all the people. How many other people? All the people. Like everybody around, everybody with an earshot of this, sees what has happened, knows what has happened, and they don't like what has happened. And so all the people saw this and they began to mutter, "He's gone to be the guest of a sinner." The people cannot fathom that Jesus would do what he has just done because tax collectors, nobody made friends with those guys. But Jesus does. There's this line from the Mishnah. It's an ancient compendium of Jewish rabbinical teaching. It says this: tax collectors who enter a house make the house unclean. Here's the idea. Tax collectors were so reviled in the ancient world. If you ever had one over at your house, you would need to pull out your vacuum and your duster and everything once they left. Because they would make your whole house unclean. They were full of sin. And yet Jesus doesn't seem to have any problem hanging out with a tax collector. He doesn't have any problem going over to a tax collector's house. That would have been unthinkable, unacceptable to anybody watching. But even though that would have been unthinkable and unacceptable to anybody watching, what Jesus does for Zacchaeus has a profound and an immediate impact on. Luke 19, verse 8, but Zacchaeus stood up and he said to the Lord, "Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I've cheated anybody out of anything, I'll pay back four times that amount." Now, I love this little phrase here. Here and now, Zacchaeus says. Here and now, I give half my possessions to the poor. The reason I love that phrase is because it carries with it such a profound sense of immediacy, right? Zacchaeus says, it's not that I'm going to, at a future time and at a future date, give half of my possessions to the poor. It's that I am giving half of my possessions to the poor right here and right now. Let's get it done. It's not that I will pay back four times over anything that I've cheated anybody out of. It's that I'm going to do that right now. Where's my checkbook? Zacchaeus is changing his life right here and right now. And make no mistake about it, the change in Zacchaeus' life is monumental. Jewish tradition said that if you wanted to be really, really generous, if you wanted to be good at sharing, you could give away up to 20% of your possessions. But that, according to the ancient Jewish rabbis, is where generosity should max out. No more than 20%. To give away more than 20% would be considered reckless, feckless, and foolish. I want to show you a quote from the Babylonian Talmud, another ancient compendium of Jewish rabbinical teaching. It says, if a man desires to spend really liberally, if you want to be really generous, you should not spend more than a fifth, 20%, since by spending more, he might himself come to be in need of the help of other people. Jewish rabbis would say, give away 20%, but no more. Otherwise, if you give away more, you may go to the poorhouse yourself, and it's no good to try to help the poor and make yourself poor. Here's Zacchaeus, and he says, the rabbis, I'm not going to give away 20% of my stuff. I'm going to give away 50% of my stuff, half of my possessions. Not only that, Zacchaeus says in verse 8, if I've cheated anybody out of anything, I'm going to pay back four times the amount. Now, Jewish law did provide for restitution if you had been cheated out of something. The Pharisees actually had different levels of restitution depending on how you were cheated. And you could receive back four times the amount that had been taken from you under certain circumstances. The Pharisees said, okay, if somebody takes from you an oxen or a sheep, and if they slaughter it, kill it, and sell it, and if there are at least three eyewitnesses who saw them take this oxen and sheep, slaughter it, kill it, and sell it, then you should receive back four times what was taken for you. That was the steepest penalty of restitution that could be leveled against somebody. Now, my guess is Zacchaeus does not meet all these qualifications for all the stuff that he has taken from other people in kind of an underhanded way. But what Zacchaeus does is he takes the steepest of these penalties and he applies it to himself willingly. There's no judge, there's no court, there's no gavel, there's no command that he has to pay back four times the amount that he has stolen from other people. Zacchaeus just says, I want to do this. I get to do this. I can't wait to be generous. I can't wait to share. Zacchaeus doesn't look at this as a penalty. He looks at it as an opportunity to give. Here's what we're witnessing. We are witnessing nothing less than a complete transformation in Zacchaeus' heart. When the story starts, Zacchaeus' heart is bent toward money, getting rich, living high on the hog. But now Zacchaeus' heart is bent toward generosity, sharing, loving others. Jesus finally says to him, Luke 19, verses 9 and 10, today salvation has come to this house because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save that which was lost. When Jesus sees the change in Zacchaeus' heart, Jesus commends Zacchaeus. In a day where everybody would have thought that a tax collector was a scoundrel, you know what Jesus calls him? A son. This man too, Jesus says, is a son of Abraham. But here's what I want you to really notice, okay? Notice not only that change is affected in Zacchaeus' life, but how change is affected in Zacchaeus' life. Change is affected in Zacchaeus' life because somebody shared with him. Somebody gave to him his time, his attention, his love, his friendship. His grace, His conversation. Somebody shared. And that simple act of sharing set Zacchaeus' life on a completely different course. Somebody shared with Zacchaeus, and Zacchaeus had it inspired in his heart to share with others. That's what Jesus does when he shares with people. When Jesus shares with people, it inspires in them a desire to share. When Jesus shares with you, does it inspire in you a desire to share? You know, as we wrap up, I want to give you just a few reasons why sharing is so incredibly important. Because sharing is something that Jesus loves to do. And sharing is something that we can love to do too. And so let me give you just a few reasons that it's good to share. First reason is because we got a lot. We do. Look at it this way, okay? According to economic records, if you make over $32,500 a year net, you're in the top 1% of the richest people in the world. Now, here's the deal. Is $32,500 net a huge amount of money, yes or no? No, it's not. But here's what that does indicate. It does indicate that the rest of the world is really, 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 really poor. And the extreme poverty of the rest of the world makes even the moderate poverty of this part of the world look kind of rich. Now, the reason that I bring this up is because it puts things into perspective. Because even if you're nowhere near wealthy by the standards of this country, compared to the folks, a lot of folks in the rest of the world, we got a lot. And this is an important reminder because it reminds us that there's probably not a single one of us in this room today who doesn't have some means to share something. Just got to get intentional about it. Figure out what you're going to share and then share it. If netting $32,500 a year means that you're in the top 1% of the world's earners, that means there's a lot of poverty out there. And that leads me to the next reason that we can share, because there's just a lot of need out there. And yes, the need is huge. At least 80% of humanity lives on less than 10 bucks a day. The poorest 40% of the world's population accounts for about 5% of the total income of the globe. 22,000 children each day die due to poverty. Around 27 to 28% of all children in developing countries are estimated to be underweight because they don't have enough food to eat. About 1.1 billion people in developing countries don't have adequate access to water. Now, you hear numbers like this, maybe you've heard numbers like this before, and you go, yeah, that's bad, but that's big. I can't fix that. And you know what? You're right. Nobody can fix global poverty single-handedly, but that's not the point. The point is that the big need in our world can inspire us to make a little difference in just one person's life. Look at it this way. You got a hand-me-down that you want to hand down to somebody else? Do it. It's a good way to share. You got some food that can go to a food pantry? Bring it. It's a good way to share. You leave a nice tip for a waiter or a waitress just to make their day a little bit brighter? Leave it. It's a great way to share. You drop 20 bucks to an organization like Lutheran World Relief because you are concerned about water or famine or whatever it is? Drop it. It's a good way to share. It's true. Nobody can fix global poverty single-handedly. And just so you know, in the brokenness of this world, you know how long the poor are going to be with us? Until Jesus returns. But we can bless lives one life at a time. You know, one of the fascinating things about Zacchaeus is that when he gives half his wealth and pays back four times the amount that he's cheated people out of, he doesn't do that to assuage his guilt. This isn't like, oh, I've done really terrible things. He's excited. He does it because he sees a need and he's happy to help. He sees people he's cheated out of, their income no longer as sources of income for him, but as people who he can bless. Do you see need not just across the world, but among people in your life? If you do, you got a reason to share. Third reason to share then is simply this, because you trust in Jesus. Because you trust in Jesus. Pastor mentioned this, you know, one of the biggest reasons that people give as to why they don't trust Jesus is because they think that people who follow Jesus are nothing but a bunch of hypocrites. They won't go to church because they think it's full of nothing but a bunch of hypocrites. People who are self-righteous charlatans. They love to judge everybody else in their sin, and they never took a long, hard look in the mirror at their own sin. Now, what I love about this story of Zacchaeus is that it gives us this great picture. Zacchaeus, as the story opens, he's in a crowd of people. You know who these people are? Really, they are. They're hypocrites. They hate Zacchaeus. They hate his sin. They love to judge him in his sin. They don't seem to be very introspective when it comes to their own sin. And so Zacchaeus has a choice. He can say, you know what? All of these hypocrites around me, forget them. They're no better than I am. I'm going to get angry. I'm just going to leave. Forget it. I don't need this. I don't need to be judged. I don't need any of that. I'm going to get out of here. But Zacchaeus doesn't do that. Instead of being in the crowd, what Zacchaeus does is he gets up over the crowd. He climbs a tree, and he doesn't care what the hypocritical people down below are saying about him. And because he gets over the crowd, you know who he sees? Jesus. And you know who he meets? Jesus. And you know who he's changed by? Jesus. Jesus is generous to him, and so he begins to become generous to other people. Guys, when it comes to our generosity, we're called to have that same attitude. Don't be generous to a church because the church is not full of a bunch of hypocrites, because it is. Be generous to a church, let me give you the reason why, because of Jesus. Don't be generous to somebody in the world because that person is really deserving of your generosity, because they're not. Be generous to somebody in the world because of Jesus. There's this great quote from the Jewish book of wisdom called Tobit. It was written after the end of the Old Testament, before the beginning of the New Testament. This is what Tobit says. Give your bread to the hungry. Give of your clothing to the naked. That's so generous. Isn't that nice? Give all your surplus to charity. Do not let your eye begrudge the gift when you make it. Place your bread on the grave of the righteous. Be generous, but don't give any to who? The sinners. Okay, if we are generous only to people who are not sinners, how many people are we going to be generous to? Okay. And by the way, you better not be generous to yourself either, right? But in one way or another, at one level or another, this is kind of the way that we look at charity. This is kind of the way that we look at generosity and sharing. Well, I'll give to them if they prove to me their worth. Now, let me just remind you at this point that the heart and the soul, the very essence of the gospel, is all about a God who shared, who was generous with people, even though they didn't deserve it. Romans 5, verse 8, but God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. When did Christ die for us? While we were still sinners, even though we didn't deserve his death, even though we didn't deserve his grace, even though we didn't deserve his generosity, we got it anyway. God shared with us through Jesus, we share with others because of Jesus. Now, just kind of an aside here practically, okay? This can kind of free you up. Because let's face it, have you ever had an encounter with somebody who you get into a conversation with them and they want something from you, right? They want a little bit of money, they want a handout, they want this, that, or the other. And you think to yourself, I don't know if this person is telling me the truth or taking me for a ride. Anybody ever been in that situation? And on the one hand, right, you kind of like, well, I'd like to be generous, but on the other hand, are they just going to go spend that on something that will enable some addictive behavior? I don't really want to do that. Another little commercial here. That's part of the reason we do care kits here at Concordia. They allow us to be generous without enabling addictive behavior. It's a good thing. But here's the thing. Even if you listen to their story and think through it and you go, okay, I don't want to enable this kind of bad behavior, but I do want to be generous. Even if you get that call wrong, okay, even if you give to somebody who maybe you shouldn't have given to, you don't have to beat yourself up, because you don't give to somebody because they're not a charlatan. Why do you give? Because of Jesus. And so in those instances, don't get yourself all tied up. Let your conscience be at peace. You know, I mentioned at the very beginning of ABC that my daughter is not always the best at sharing with other people. But one of the things that will happen at the end of the day is usually around 4 o'clock, my wife teaches school here, first grade, and our kids go to the daycare here, and so we have the blessing of all being here Monday through Friday every day. And at the end of the day, Melody will go, and she'll pick up Hope, and she'll pick up Hayden, and she'll bring them up to my office. And I'll talk to the kids for about 2 seconds because Hope usually wants to go running down the hallway, because down the hallway, we have a staff member who has a drawer that is full of chocolate. It's true, okay? And the drawer that is full of chocolate is full of all sorts of delights, and she always wants to check out what delights are there that day. And so she'll go running down the hallways, "Hi, Dad," going to get some chocolate, and that's it, okay? She'll go running down the hallway, and she'll start rummaging through the drawer, trying to find what she can find in there to eat. And it's a funny thing, because she will usually go, and she will usually get not one, but 2 pieces of chocolate. But she doesn't get 2 pieces to eat herself. She's not very good at sharing with her brother, but what she does every day is she will come back down the hall to my office, and she'll have 1 piece of chocolate in one hand and the other piece of chocolate in the other hand, and she'll hold out that other piece of chocolate. It's usually the one that's not as good as the other piece of chocolate that she has, but nevertheless, she'll hold it out, and she'll say to me, "Daddy, I share it with you." And that just warms my heart. And so because she gives it to me, I have to eat the chocolate. And I do. You know, sharing doesn't come naturally, but a 3-year-old can learn it. If a 3-year-old can learn it, we can learn it too. Sharing takes a heart to do what Jesus has already done for us. And so, like Zacchaeus, share. Because when you do, you reflect him. Let's stand and pray. Well, Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have shared with us, even though we didn't deserve what you shared with us, your one and only Son. And so, Father, as we share with others, may we do so because of your Son. Father, may he inspire us to be generous, to be gracious, so that our grace can be shown and reflect your grace that has been shown to us and to our world. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a good week. Walk with light.